Welcome to another episode of DigSketch, a channel dedicated to digital sketching for architects. I'm Harvey Miller, and this week I'm going to go over my DigSketch architectural brush set for Procreate. With the right brushes and a little bit of practice, you can do some amazing things in a very short amount of time. Over the years, I've taken some of the app's native brushes and tweaked them for my own needs, and I've set up a few from scratch. Today, I'll be walking you through each of them and how I use them during the concept stage of the architectural design process. First, we'll start off with my pencils and how I keep things loose and abstract during the early stages. Then we'll get into the pens and ink, the brushes I use to further refine my plans or mark up ongoing progress from my team. And finally, we'll go over the hatches and effects I use to give my drawings a little extra texture and that polish needed to make them more presentable. And stay tuned because along the way, I'll show you how to tweak these brushes so you can customize them yourself to fit your own personal workflow, which you absolutely should do if you do this kind of thing for a living. So let's get into it. All right, first up are my pencils. I use these early on when we're just getting started on a project because they help me keep things loose. Here I have these three pencils. The first two are soft. There's a big one and a small one. These are pressure sensitive. And the third one is a solid pencil, which I use for writing. And again, these pencils are just for when you're starting out on a project and you're just testing out ideas. During this stage, some designers sketch very slow and methodical, but I'd encourage you to just loosen things up. Hold your pencil a little softer, overlap your lines, try freehanding slightly wavy lines, try broad, loose strokes, don't overthink it, and play some music while you're doing this part. The reason for all this is, and maybe it's just me, but I believe it makes it easier for you to tap into your intuition. There's something about just letting your hand go and allowing your mind to zoom out and think more softly to allow abstract thoughts to flow back through your hand without overthinking it. If you're sketching too slowly and methodical and too clean at this stage, your brain is too focused on drawing those perfect lines. But there's a time for that, and it comes later on. Right now, you just want to keep your mind open and free. So that brings us to my pens and ink. Let's start here at the top. This first brush here is called Pen. It's my everyday pen. And this is what's replaced my sketchbook. I'd say 90% of my sketches on my iPad are these loose, rough sketches like this that I use to develop ideas, share with my team. I use it for quick notes, markups over my team's progress, or even cartoon sets. You can set 4 preset sizes here on the slider. This is for any brush. And to set these, you just tap on the little handle and press the plus or minus button. I also use this pen to further develop my sketch plans when I'm taking it to that next level of refinement. So once I have a loose direction going with my pencil, I'll start to firm things up using my pen. I'll use this pen also when I start to study the building in section, just as things are starting to get technical. Things are still very loose, but I'm starting to look at actual dimensions, which requires a little bit more refinement than my soft pencils. And as my plans continue to develop, I'll use this pen to create the final line work for the actual presentation plans for the client. And another brush I use as the design progresses is this dashed brush, which I use to indicate overhangs or voids. You'll see there's a solid version and a soft version, which has pressure-sensitive opacity, which is also great for indicating contour lines in your site plans. There's also this smooth pen, which has stabilization turned on. It smoothens out your lines. I use this if I need to draw cleaner, smoother arcs or curves. And note that this brush is speed sensitive. If you want to draw a tighter radius, you need to go a little bit slower. And you can adjust this here in the settings. If you just click on the brush, here under stabilization, the amount it's stabilized is here. Slide it to the left to reduce stabilization and to the right to increase it. Next up is my thin fat brush, which I use for coloring. I call it this because by pressing lightly, you can have a very thin marker, and then when you press hard, it becomes a fat marker. It's great for going from tight detailed spaces to wider areas without having to switch pens. All you're doing is changing the pressure. I also have this brush set as my default eraser. It's great to have this flexibility, again, to just quickly erase various conditions without having to switch brushes. My other default eraser is my finger. It's surprisingly intuitive to just quickly erase something with your finger. And then there are my markers. I have these angled to the left and to the right. I use these primarily for shadows in my plans. I have big ones and small ones. There are solid ones. Sometimes I'll just color all solid and reduce the layer's overall opacity. I sometimes use this small solid marker for text. It has a nice designer feel to it. And then there's these pressure sensitive soft ones when I need to have them fade out. And I sometimes use drawing assist when coloring with these markers to get clean, consistent horizontal lines. And this brings us to the final section of my brushes, hatches and effects. Starting with this soft brush, which I use all the time. I use it for masking and lighting effects. I use this to create soft uplighting on facades and wall washes on elevations. Like this screen pattern, for example. Say I duplicate it, can make it brighter, then put a mask over it, and then just brush out with a black brush on the mask layer the parts I want to fade away. This gives the appearance of the light fading off. Or I may want the background of a drawing to fade out on the edges. Or I'll use it as an eraser, again when I need to create some sort of soft gradient. Or softly paint in lightness or darkness in the background if I want to create some contrast with the foreground elements or my text. This next one is the stucco brush. I guess this could be under pencils. It's really just a large soft pencil, which I use for textured walls in elevation. And you can play with the scale of this brush in the settings to achieve different scales of roughness. And it's pressure sensitive, so it's easy to achieve some lighting effects with it if you want to create this uplighting, for example. And then I have a series of hatches here, starting with the perforated hatch. You can see how I use this in one of my other videos, where I create a sculptural parametric pattern as a roof form. I call this brush the walking path. It makes it easy to create quick paths for your site plans. Or you can shade with it just by overlapping these strokes here. This next one I call parallel bands. Again, I use it for elevations to create some texture on walls. And then there are a series of other vertical and horizontal and angled hatches I use for shading. But I'll also pair these hatches up with the transform tool again to create some quick elevational or perspective studies. Like this horizontal hatch, it can quickly represent floor levels or horizontal bands in a facade. And then with the transform tool, you can warp it and sculpt it to create some depth and curvature. And then there's this light pen. This is one of Procreate's default brushes, which I use for lighting effects for fountains or LED strip lighting. I use it to give a little glow or highlight different parts of my drawing. And then there's this square brush, which I sometimes use for hard line walls. And then there's a hybrid of the light pen and the square brush, which I call the light square. It's basically the light pen with a square profile, which I use for lit up windows in elevation. And I made this by just duplicating the light pen brush and replacing the shape here. And you can essentially draw anything you want and save it as a JPEG on your iPad and make a brush out of it. Then I have this brush called Clouds, which I use for clouds, and some other brushes here for various types of water, whether it's a pool or a fountain. This one is more for ocean water. Keep in mind, you gotta adjust the scale so that it generally looks correct and the right size for your drawing. And I use this brush just to give a little depth. And last are my trees. Here we have a single tree, which I just stamp in if I need to be careful about the placement of each individual tree. This one is a line of trees, which you can just create a stroke and it'll dot them along a path. This brush scatters your trees if you have a broad area to cover to just quickly sprinkle them throughout. And again, you can play with these settings here in the brush settings. You can control the amount of scatter. And I have a circle tree here for just a more simplified version. And then there's this brush called Dirt, which just sprinkles some texture across your site plan. So you can make your own brush set by clicking here on this plus, renaming it, and then just dragging your favorite brushes in. And I highly recommend doing this to just create a brush set that works with your workflow. And this will change over time as you try out new techniques. So there are many brush sets you could download off the web. I'll leave a link to mine in the description below. But this kind of thing just takes some trial and error. You gotta just experiment to find what brushes work best for the type of work you do and that fit your personal style of sketching. And it isn't static. My brush set has been evolving over the years. I'm constantly adding to it and refining it as I discover new techniques. And if you get my pro brush set below, you'll have lifetime access to all of my future updates. So have some fun with this, and until then, I'll see you in the next video.